Welcome to another live Action for Happiness event. We're here talking about self-care in hard times. We're going to be talking about this wonderful concept of self-compassion, about dealing with burnout, about community and how we can support each other. It's really exciting to see so many of you joining us, as always, from all around the world. And I'm delighted that we're joined once again for our 100th, would you believe, webinar like this with the wonderful Dr. Kristin Neff. Kristin, lovely to see you here.
Thanks, Mark. It's great to be here. I just love your organization.
Well, you were one of the first to join me for one of these live events back in the 2020 year when these first launched. And we've been blown away to have had now over 450,000 people join for one of these live events. Thank you to everyone who's tuned in. If you're a regular, welcome back. If you're new to this, thank you for being part of the Action for Happiness community, a wonderful movement of people all around the world trying to create a happier and kinder world together. And today's topic of self-care, self-compassion is so important because it's the foundation. It's not only the way we want to be for others in the world, but it's also about the way we can be there for ourselves, especially in difficult times. And we have one of the world's leading experts to help us explore this. So in a moment, I'll allow Kristin to introduce herself properly. But just to say, please do keep it kind, as always, in the chat and use the Q&A function. So if you have a question for Kristin, please put it in the Q&A and we'll come to that a little bit later on. But Kristin, you are one of the world's leading experts in this. You helped define the term self-compassion from an academic perspective. But maybe you could say a little bit more about your journey and particularly why this theme has become such a part of your life.
Yeah, so I certainly didn't invent the idea of self-compassion. I actually first learned about it my last year of graduate school in the 90s. And basically, I was a mess. I had gotten married young and gotten divorced young. So I was feeling very kind of bad about myself, like a failure. And I was also under a lot of stress because I was about to finish up my PhD and I had no idea if I would get a job. And so I had heard that mindfulness meditation was supposed to be good for stress. And so fortunately for me, the mindfulness class I signed up for was taught in the tradition of a teacher named Thich Nhat Hanh. Many people have probably heard of him, who was always one of the Buddhist teachers who talked the most explicitly about self-compassion. So the very first night I went, the woman leading the course talked about the importance of being a good friend to yourself, you know, turning the lens of compassion inward as well as outward. And it's funny because it took me a while to figure out this mindfulness thing, but the very first, literally the very first night I went to this course, I went home afterward and I said, okay, Kristin, you know, you're having a hard time. You're feeling badly about yourself. It's okay. You're only human. You know, I'm here for you. It's going to be okay. And kind of gave myself this friendly support. And like immediately made a difference in my ability to cope with all my stress. And then so I did get a job finally at the University of Texas at Austin, and I decided to conduct research on it. And that's, you might say, kind of my contribution, but it's really about how self-compassion helped me personally in my personal life, which is why I'm so passionate about it.
It's wonderful to hear the kind of personal connection as well as the academic, influence you've had with sharing this with so many people and now, of course, turning it into some amazing practical resources. And we will later on talk about some of the resources you have and ways that people can get involved and learn more. But I think, as always with Action for Happiness, we love to put this into practice right here and now. So I wonder, Kristin, maybe before we even dive into what we really mean by self-compassion, maybe you could take us through one of your exercises to help us get in the right mind space for this.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So just to back up, if you look at the root of the word compassion in the Latin, passion is to suffer, cum is with. So it really is about, how do we show up when things are difficult and hard times and when there's suffering present? And the idea with self-compassion is we show up the same way with the same kindness and support that we naturally show to others. So it's kind of interesting to investigate, well, how do we show up in hard times? So if everyone, listening or watching this wants, you can take out a piece of paper if you want to do this as a little writing exercise, or you can just close your eyes and go internally. But I'd like you to consider how you show up for your good friends when they're struggling in some way. Right? Maybe they failed in some way and were feeling badly about themselves, or they're having some crisis in their life. They're going through some sort of hard time. And how do you show up for your good friends? Maybe just thinking a little bit, what are the types of things you usually say? What's your tone of voice like? What do you do with your body? Do you like put your hand on their shoulder? Just think about that for a moment. And now I would like you to consider, how do you show up for yourself when you're struggling? Maybe you've, you know, made a mistake in some way, you're feeling badly about yourself, or you're just going through a real challenge. You know, how do you relate to yourself? What types of things do you often say to yourself? What's your tone of voice like? What do you do with your body? Just take a moment to actually really reflect on that. And then lastly, I would like you to consider the differences, if there are any, there probably are, the differences in how you show up for your good friends versus yourself. So some of these may be the types of things you say, or your tone of voice, or what you do with your body. Some of it may be more subtle, like, you know, maybe with your friends, you immediately point out, well, the situation was stressful. Of course you reacted that way. And with yourself, it's all my fault. Or maybe with your friends, you remind them, this is temporary, you know, it will pass. And with yourself, you think, oh, this is forever and always. Right? So what are some of the patterns of difference you can see between how you relate to your friends when they're struggling and how you relate to yourself when you're struggling? Right. So, and just to say, if you're like most people, you'll see that you're actually a lot kinder, more supportive and caring toward your friends when they struggle than yourself. And so really self-compassion is a very humble agenda. We just learn to be more friendly and supportive to ourselves. And just think about how your friend would react if you treated them the way you treat yourself and the consequences of that. And then if you think of the opposite, what might be the benefits, just like the benefits to your friend of acting in this more supportive way, those are the same types of benefits that we get when we're self-compassionate. So.
Thank you, Kristin. That's not the first time I've done that exercise with you, but it doesn't lose any of its profound nature for me. I found that really moving and quite shocking, actually. And particularly remember the first time I ever did that comparison. And I'd be interested to hear what others in the community found then. But a bit like you described at the end, I was really shocked to see how differently I treat someone I love and care about and how I talk to myself. And particularly in my case, the language I use. Like, I found that I call myself an effing idiot. And I'm very, very rude to myself when I feel like I've made a mistake, much less tolerant, much less understanding of it might have been a difficult situation, much less forgiving. And that was a wake-up call for me. And I'm not saying I've solved that since, but even just what you've helped us do there, sort of mindful awareness of this disconnect, really life-changing for me. So thank you for drawing that to our attention. I saw a few comments in the chat there from people saying about the differences, but maybe I just invite people just to say a few words about whether they notice a difference between how they talk to a loved one and themselves. Maybe commenting particularly on how they feel they talk to themselves. And let's just read a few of the things out that come up in the chat here. So how do you find that you do talk to yourself, people? And I'll read some out. Deborah says, often harsher with myself. We seem to be programmed to be self-critical, less tolerant, you know, hard on myself, never quite good enough. People surprised to hear that I'm so harsh on myself. Yeah, sometimes we don't realize people have this going on in their heads. Frustrated, shocked, quick to see the worst in myself. I guess, Kristin, you've seen these kind of responses time and time again. Is that right?
Yeah, so that's typical. And the person who mentioned we're pre-programmed to do this, there's actually some truth to it. I mean, so if you're beating yourself up, don't beat yourself up for doing so, because it probably is an evolutionary survival adaptation, right? So when we're threatened in some way, and of course, when we make a mistake or we feel badly about ourselves, we feel threatened, we go into fight, flight, or freeze mode. And so we turn that inward as a way to try to be safe. So we beat ourselves up. That's kind of the fight mode. Or we flee into a sense of shame and isolation, or we freeze and we ruminate, we get fixate, you know, whereas evolutionarily, when those in our in-group or our family members are threatened, we have the tend and befriend mode, right? We more naturally adapt to this caring, warm response. That's the way we were evolved to have safety with other people. And so it is true. It's a little more natural to be harsh with ourselves and kind to others. The good news is it's very easy to tap into that care system. We don't have to invent a new skill. We don't, you know, it's also part of our biology. We just have to learn to kind of do a little hack so we start treating ourselves like we treat others. So it's maybe not natural, but it's easier than you think because you already know how to do it.
So that's interesting. So first of all, that to me says we don't need to blame ourselves for this because it is an instinct that perhaps has some validity to it. But actually, as you say, the instinct of being kind and caring and nurturing is also built in. We just tend to show it to others, not ourselves. Is that what you meant?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And so what we're doing is we're doing something. We're using a system that's very strong in us, and we're turning the lens of compassion inward. The hardest thing is, well, first of all, remembering. It can be difficult to remember. And then also giving ourselves permission that, you know, our culture usually doesn't say that this is a good thing to practice from the time you're little. So we have to overcome some blocks to it. But the actual act of self-compassion, it's a lot less work than tearing yourself to shreds. Feels better. It's more effective. There's so many mental health benefits, physical health benefits when we do it. But it's not completely natural. So that's the little hump we need to get over.
Well, later on, I know you're going to take us through another practice to help us learn some of the foundations of it. But let's just, before we talk about some of the cultural challenges to self-compassion, because I think you're right, we don't set ourselves up to do this naturally. What are some of the day-to-day ways that you have found in your own life allow you to make this more natural? What are some practices that you use in your daily life, or some ways you've seen others sort of almost switch this in when it wasn't there before?
Yeah, so one very easy way to do it, it's probably my go-to practice, is physical touch. And that's partly because of the physiological foundations of compassion. You know, so babies, human infants, are designed by evolution to respond to caring touch as a signal of compassion way before language comes in, right? And so if I'm upset by something or feeling badly about myself, my instinct is to put my hands on my body in some sort of supportive way. Usually that's the first step. And when we do that, we are changing our physiology. You know, we're reducing cortisol levels, increasing heart rate variability. We're actually going from sympathetic to parasympathetic nervous response. So starting with the body, and then you can, you know, a very easy way to think about self-compassion is you can just say, what would I say to my best friend if they were going through the exact same thing? And then it flows a lot more easily. And then you can do a U-turn and say that to yourself. So those are the types of things that I use. And, you know, again, it's not rocket science. It's pretty simple.
Yeah, I love that last example, actually, about, in fact, we have a program called the 10 Days of Happiness, which is a little online action program that many people here will have done or shared with others. It helps you learn the skills. And on the day about resilience and self-compassion, it basically says, in a difficult situation, imagine that your friend is going through this situation. What would you say to them? And we're all quite good at answering that. You know, you'd say, don't worry, it's not your fault, it's going to be okay. And then it's now say the same thing to yourself. So we know how to do both those things. We just don't normally put them together. That's the thing.
And also, and by the way, sometimes, you know, some of us may struggle with being super as compassionate as we'd like to others. So we could also imagine, what would a really compassionate person say to me right now? Or even like, what would Obi-Wan Kenobi or something, some cultural figure? We have these templates of compassion in our repertoire. And so all we really need to do is plug in one of those templates that we aren't used to drawing upon.
Well, I have to say that I may be in danger of taking away another life-changing nugget. If I can have Obi-Wan Kenobi in my head,
you know,
on a daily basis, Kristin, I'm in.
Ted Lasso or someone 70s. Like that.
That works for me, yeah.
Yeah.
So in terms of our culture, I mean, we've talked about in the title of this event, self-care in hard times, and there's a lot going on globally and in all of our lives, a lot of sort of tumult and uncertainty. And a word I know that you've been thinking about and looking at, or a concept you've been looking at, and in fact are writing a book about at the moment, is burnout. So it feels sort of linked to this topic of why we need to be able to care for ourselves. Would you say a little bit about what's going on with burnout and why you think it's so relevant right now?
Yeah, so, you know, again, backing up to what compassion is. So when suffering is present, that could be physical discomfort, it could be stress, it could be the world situation, any sort of negative thought or emotion or feeling. If we're not able to be with what's arising with strength and resilience, we become overwhelmed. And so what one of the main things self-compassion does is give us the strength to be with difficulty and with stress and, you know, distress in a way that allows us to be strong and stable. However, burnout is a result of when our resources are not up to the task of coping with the stressors placed on us. So, you know, even if maybe you don't beat yourself up, but you're in such a stressful job that, you know, day after day, you just can't cope any longer. All right. So when we can't cope, what we tend to do naturally is just shut down. And so burnout expresses itself in three main ways. One is just feelings of exhaustion. You know, you're just so tired, you can't get out of bed. Another one, which is very interesting, is feelings of incompetence. We can't get out of bed, we're exhausted. And then we tend to blame ourselves and think that we should be able to get out of bed, or it's somehow our fault for not being able to do that. So we internalize it and feel incompetent and useless. Also, especially because our value is so linked to our productivity. And so when we're exhausted and we can't be as productive, we also judge ourselves, our self-esteem goes down. And then the third one is depersonalization, which is just a fancy word for saying we don't care as much anymore. We don't care about as much about the people we work with or that we care for. We don't care about life as much. We just shut down and we go numb. Again, is it not to judge that? It's a completely natural response to being overwhelmed by stress. But self-compassion is so useful for this at all three levels. First of all, one of the things about self-compassion is that it's really a matter of saying, what do I need right now? And valuing our own needs. For instance, drawing boundaries. Sometimes what I need to do is to say no to your request for my time or energy and resources. So when we value what we need and we actually ask ourselves that, then instead of just giving it all away constantly, we're more willing to draw boundaries and say no when we need to. That can help us be less exhausted. When we are exhausted, we don't exacerbate it by judging ourselves and blaming ourselves for it. We're kind of kind and supportive. So that not only reduces exhaustion, but also reduces these feelings of incompetence. And then, you know, we can still, when we keep our heart open to ourselves, it's easier to keep our heart open to others and to the world. You know, so once the care goes inward, it's actually easier to maintain it outward. And so there's a lot of research on this showing that one of the gifts of self-compassion is when we resource ourselves. In other words, when compassion flows inward, we're more able to keep giving to the world and it reduces burnout.
I think that's so powerful, actually, because I'm seeing in the chat there's a lot of people really resonating with burnout, particularly people working in, you know, health services. And there's a lot of people actually doing incredibly compassionate work to help others that have just intolerable situations, workloads. And actually, those things you described to me feel like us just not able to show up as our best selves. We're tired. We don't care as much. We feel like, you know, we're not really thriving and we're not bringing the best of ourselves. And that's the sort of it's a collective loss as much of it as an individual loss in a way. So actually using self-care helps us to replenish ourselves, but presumably this self-compassion also then means we can show up more for others as well.
Yeah, and so self-care, the word self-care is interesting. So self-care is absolutely part of self-compassion. But when people think of self-care, they often just think of behaviors, which are important, you know, saying no or taking a rest or, you know, doing yoga, whatever you need to do to take care of yourself. But what's really important, you know, the $100, that's right first. the gold standard self-care is emotional self-care. Because sometimes, you know, you're so busy, you don't have time. You can't say no. You know, maybe you're caring for your sick parent or something. You can't say no. You can't draw a boundary. You can't take time for yourself. But you can at least be there for yourself emotionally when you feel just exhausted and drained. Like, oh, I'm so sorry you're feeling this. I'm here for you. How can I help? You know, I care. That care, that nurturing, that warmth, that goodwill is itself energizing and rewarding. And so that's really the most important aspect of self-care. The other is important as well, but you know, we have a little less control about how much actual behavioral self-care we can do.
I think that's in some ways the self-care memes and conversations that happen in the world of influencers strike me sometimes as a little bit flippant and shallow and sort of, you know, it's just about, you know, taking a scented candle and a moment of peace and calm. But you're talking about something that's a bit deeper and more profound about the way we are with ourselves, which I think is important. And often that subtle, all that depth is missed, I think, in some of the popular conversations about this.
Yeah. And here's a way in which it really goes deep and in some ways even goes spiritual is what we're really doing with self-compassion, if you think about it, is we're moving away from what's happening, the stress, the distress, the negative thoughts, emotions, whatever's happening. And we're moving into our awareness of what's happening, our loving awareness of what's happening. So that your mind, your awareness, instead of being just consumed by the distress or the problems, your mind is actually resting in this loving, connected presence that's with the distress. So as an example, I talk a lot about, you know, my son, Rowan, who's just a gift to the world, but he is autistic. He's doing great. But when he was young, it was, you know, it was quite challenging, but I had also had my self-compassion practice. And I would find myself in these situations, you know, these horrible situations where he was tantruming and I couldn't reach him. And it just felt like everything was going wrong. And I practiced self-compassion. So not only is, you know, the tantrum happening, there's also this sense of care and kindness and connectedness and kind of peacefulness associated with my compassionate mind state. And believe it or not, I could actually find moments of satisfaction, of peace and happiness, even though what was happening was very negative. And when you think about the power of that, if our happiness isn't controlled by what's happening and our happiness stems instead from, is our heart open? You know, are we in a state of mindful presence? Do we feel connected to the larger whole? If that's where our happiness comes from, then this is something we can access all the time. It's unlimited.
Yeah, well said. Since we last spoke and did one of these events together, you've also written another book after your fantastic first book about self-compassion. And I was struck by the title. Well, you and I have never talked about it, but you called it something about fierce self-compassion. And I'd love to hear your explanation for that. But for me, I guess what's happened there is when people hear about self-compassion, they often assume that it's almost a soft way of being, that we're sort of almost, you know, being gentle with ourselves, and we might lose our cutting edge and our drive to succeed and so on. And I have a feeling that's not what you're saying with genuine self-compassion. So what is this idea of being fiercely self-compassionate? Where does that come from?
Yeah, so there are really two ways we can desire to alleviate our suffering, right? One is what I call tender self-compassion, and that is about unconditional self-acceptance. So, you know, when we know that the bottom line is we're worthy, regardless of, you know, what's happening or whether or not we succeed or fail, It's also the kind of the acceptance of our emotions, the fact that, okay, this is a really difficult moment. Can I accept that with tenderness and warmth? And that helps us be well. But sometimes acceptance is not the way to alleviate our suffering. If I'm doing something to myself or others that's causing harm, I can accept myself, but I don't want to accept the behavior. And I certainly don't want to accept situations that are causing harm. Let's say I'm in an unfair work environment, or, you know, my partner's being abusive or something like that's happening. So this is where we need fierce self-compassion. This is about taking action to alleviate our suffering. And that's weird. I just lost my train of thought. I think I'm distracted by the thing. Okay. So it could take three main forms. One is through protecting ourselves, like drawing boundaries, speaking up for ourselves, saying no. One is through providing for ourselves, asking ourselves, what do I need in the moment? You know, what actions do I need to take? It might be self-care, for instance. And then the third one, really key, is motivating change. People make a big mistake when they think self-compassion is just about acceptance and not changing ourselves. Because again, just like with a parent, you love your kid unconditionally, but you want your kid to like be toilet trained and like go to school and learn how to drive a car. You don't want to just like keep them as they are forever. That's a big part of nurturing their growth and learning. That's a big part of loving your child, even though you love them unconditionally. It's the same thing with ourselves. So we can love ourselves unconditionally, accept ourselves unconditionally, at the same time that because we care, not because we aren't good enough if we don't, but because we care, we want to motivate change, reach our full potential and unhealthy habits and behaviors. That's a really important part of compassion that people get confused about.
I really love this, because actually that example you've given about, well, I guess in some ways parenting. So when I think about the style I want to be as a parent, it is that blend of unconditional love, but also kind of clear boundaries and expectations. Yes. And actually, what you're really saying is we need to be that good, nurturing parent to ourselves, you know, kindness and love and boundaries and expectations. And it's that combination of softness and, I guess, some kind of kind firmness that's
yeah, together. Well, I call it fierce, but you can.
Fierce,
you
know, yeah.
The combination I like to call a caring force, it's powerful, it's forceful. I like to use the mama bear example. Like there's mama bear, who's very peaceful and loving and sweet. And then there's mama bear, which is like, okay, you know, first of all, you attack my cubs, or if you attack me, I'm going to be fiercely saying no, draw boundaries, protect myself. I'm going to provide myself, you know, the mama bear, she may hunt for miles to get enough fish for her cubs. And then when it's time for those cubs to leave, she kicks them out of the den, right? When they need to make it on their own. So those qualities, again, of protection, of providing, and the motivating change are really essential part of fierce self-compassion.
Before we come to questions and answers, and I can see we've already got some great questions in the audience. One of the things that I know you're passionate about, and of course, you know, and everyone here knows that we're passionate about, is community and togetherness. So yes. In some ways, self-compassion that we talked about is a personal practice. It's an inward way of being with ourselves so we can show up in a different way in the world. But as we have been saying since the start of Action for Happiness, that togetherness, supporting each other, being part of a community. And so I guess within that, providing encouragement, having like-minded people, having a sense of camaraderie, togetherness in difficult times, these feel to me like they're vital building blocks. So although we want self-compassion within ourselves, we also need it between each other in a way.
Yes.
What's been your experience there? And I know you've been trying to build now more recently a self-compassion community as well. Do you want to say a bit about that?
Yeah. And so have I mentioned the three components of self-compassion yet? If not, I might just briefly say what they are.
Because I know you're going to take us through them in a moment in a practice. But yeah.
But I mean, just to say what they are, it's relevant to this community thing. So there are three elements. One is the kindness. That's kind of the one we've been talking about. Mindfulness actually is a part of self-compassion. You have to be present. You have to be able to be aware of and present with our suffering in order to respond. But the third element is common humanity. And this is what differentiates self-compassion from self-pity. Self-pity is woe is me, poor me. Self-compassion is, well, I'm a human being. I'm not alone in this. Other people have similar experiences, not the same, but we all struggle. And this common humanity piece is kind of the most subtle and often the most difficult to build, because we just think in that moment, not rationally, but we feel as if everyone else is living, you know, a normal problem-free life. You know, certainly Mark Williamson doesn't criticize himself. You know, Kristin Neff never gets angry. You know, we assume that we're the only one having these problems. And this is where community helps so much in building this common humanity piece of self-compassion. When we can see other people struggle like we do, we aren't alone, there's nothing wrong with us. And it also kind of, it expands our view. When we're in community practicing self-compassion, our sense of self kind of naturally goes from me to we. Yeah. If we're in this community practicing together. And even though the word self is in self-compassion, when you turn the light of compassion inward, there's not a lot of self there. It's just a human being, like all human beings, who are struggling, trying to be safe and wanting to be loved. And so the best way I have found, the most effective way to practice self-compassion is with the help of others in community. And it also helps because it's not natural, like because it's more natural for others and not for ourselves through evolution, having other people remind us to be kind, you know, and just kind of having that sense that the compassion's already activated because you're being compassionate to someone else. Then you kind of just slip yourself in. That happens in community also. There's lots of reasons why it's so important to do this, for us to do this together.
And in the follow-up email after this event, we'll send a link not only to your resources and your new book on burnout, which I mentioned, but also to your self-compassion community, where I gather you have some sort of guides that can bring groups together and help people learn some of this together.
Yeah, so it's an online membership community, and it's very low monthly fee. And if you can't afford it, we have scholarships. We don't want to turn anyone away. But basically, we've got community gatherings with me. People ask me questions. I have guest events for community gatherings. We have mentor sessions where in a small group, people can, you know, talk to the mentor and talk with each other. We have a sharing corner. And then we also have resources like videos, learning videos, and a whole practice toolkit. I've recorded like 40 new practices that are available to members. This is really just to bump up your ability to practice self-compassion. Yeah.
Kristin, this has been wonderful. And I want to come to questions. But before we do that, let's do another practice together, because you mentioned those three components of self-compassion. But I think, as ever, it's lovely to have a chance to experience this together. So would you like to, before we move to questions, take us through another self-compassion practice?
Yes, I would. And before I do that, I am just going to try to fix my focus, because it looks like I am out of focus. It's partly why I got the new camera. If it's not one thing, it's another. It's either clear and dead, or it works and it's... Anyway, well, that will
I always like to think these events are a chance to practice our resilience and self-compassion in action. So.
Yeah, so I'll practice this for myself. Okay. So I'd like to lead everyone through what's called a self-compassion break. And it's a way of bringing in intentionally the three components of self-compassion. We bring in some mindfulness, we remind ourselves of our shared humanity, and we give ourselves kindness. And then we also throw in a little physical touch, because again, that can activate the parasympathetic nervous system. And so this is something you can do. I'll probably lead it about a 5-minute version, but you can do this in 1 minute. It doesn't take long. You can just do it as we call it a self-compassion break, because it kind of breaks you out of your normal way of relating to yourself or your emotions. It's like a little reset button on the computer. Okay. So, all right. So if everyone please closes, if you close your eyes. Settle into your body. Notice your own presence right here, right now. So I would invite you to think about some challenge you're having in your life right now, or some difficulty you're having. This might be something in a relationship or at work. Maybe a health challenge, Or maybe you're feeling badly about yourself for some reason, made a mistake or failed at something. But please don't choose anything that's really overwhelming, because if you're overwhelmed, you won't be able to focus on the practice, learning the practice. So choose something that's mild to moderately distressing, but not hugely so. And just really bring the situation to mind, what's happening or what happened, what might happen. And we'd like to bring some mindfulness to what we're experiencing. So not only is this happening, and we also want to become aware, right? Really focus on being aware of what's happening and also noticing, relating to it by validating, this is hard, right? What's happening right now is painful, it's difficult. Right, this is mindfulness when we become aware of what's happening. We also want to remember that we aren't alone in this, right? In the sense that human life, being a human being, is about having things like this happen. Right. There's nothing wrong with you for experiencing this. And you certainly aren't alone. You know, people struggle in different ways. Our situations are not the same. But struggle is part of living a human life. Imperfection is part of being human. And so just knowing that your version of imperfection, however that's manifesting, is actually what connects you to others, not what separates you. But because it is painful, we want to bring some kindness and warmth to ourselves. And so one way to do that is through physical touch. So I'd invite you maybe to put your hands on your heart, or maybe kind of fold your arms or hold your face, some sort of physical gesture that feels comfortable. You're kind of literally holding yourself in the midst of thinking about this painful situation. And by the way, if you've already drifted off, you may want to remind yourself of your painful situation. Right. And also as you're calling it up in your awareness, also really holding yourself, feeling the warmth of your hands, that connectedness of your hands on your body, strengthening yourself with your hands. And then offering some words of kindness to yourself, words of support, or encouragement, maybe words of acceptance if that's what you need. Maybe some fierce words if that's what you need. And if you don't know what you need to hear, an easy way to think about it is, what if a really good friend or a loved one was experiencing something very similar to what you're experiencing? Imagine that. And what might you say to them, which is what they need to hear? What might you say to comfort them, to let them know that you care, that they have your support? And can you try saying something similar to yourself? may feel awkward. That's okay. Just let that be so. But is it possible for you to start relating to yourself in a more friendly, supportive way? Okay, and then letting the practice go. And I just want to follow that up, Mark, by saying, you know, sometimes people do something like this and they feel good, they feel peaceful, they feel the compassion flowing. Other times, sometimes people feel the opposite, right? So there's the term we have called backdraft, which is like when you open the doors of your heart, the fresh air, the compassion runs, it flows in, and all the old pain rushes out. And it can actually feel like you're doing it wrong, but it's really you're doing it right. But sometimes the pain, if it rushes out too quickly, it can kind of be a little destabilizing. So it doesn't mean you're doing it wrong. It just means sometimes it's a sign you need to go a little more slowly. You know, and it's not so much, again, about what we're feeling. It's our intention, this goodwill intention to support ourselves. And that's really the most important part of the practice.
Thank you so much, Kristin. Really powerful stuff. And In a way, I have a mindfulness practice that I do every day. And of course, with mindfulness, I'm trying to let go of any sense of judgment and just be in a space of awareness. But what I like about the practices you just showed us there and the point you just made is that we are bringing an intention of sort of care to what's coming up. So it feels like it's more intentional rather than just sort of passive awareness. And I think that feels...
Yes.
Different in that sense. Am I right there?
Yes. And I know a lot of times mindfulness practitioners, they'll get a little confused because mindfulness is a type of acceptance. It's an acceptance of our moment to moment experience.
Yes.
And so it can feel like, well, when I'm bringing something into it, I'm not supposed to be doing anything. But really it's a dance of being and doing. So there's like the, you know, the thing about mindfulness is it generates goodwill, and goodwill naturally takes a form of action, wanting to help in some way. So the being and doing are both there. And simultaneously, the mindfulness is more aimed at what's arising. The compassion is more aimed at ourselves, the sentient being that's experiencing what's arising.
Yeah.
So they have slightly, we can wish well for ourselves. We can even take action. At the same time, we kind of accept the moment-to-moment imperfection of what's arising.
Yeah, it's this is what is happening, and
yeah.
I'm going to accept it, and I'm going to respond kindly to it and myself in this moment.
Yes, and
powerful.
In the moment, I can't change anything, but the way I relate to the moment now is going to actually influence how the next moments unfold. And there's a reason we practice meditation is because we want those future moments to unfold in a healthier way.
So. Let's come to the questions, Kristin. So Hallie has asked the most upvoted question here. How can we begin a journey of self-care or self-compassion if our default has always been to neglect or minimize and dismiss our own needs? Goes on to say, I feel I'm doing the practical things for self-care, but there's an emotional disconnect as if it isn't reaching a deeper level for me. So thank you, Hallie, for that question. I think it's really beautifully put. What would you say?
Yeah, so it's really good just to start where you are. Right. So in other words, you can even tune into it's kind of some, you know, pain there. That's, you know, like when you said that, by the way, you know, I know I have a lot of British friends and it's kind of part of the culture, right? You know, you just don't complain. And, you know, there's a lot of cultural conditioning that can make it difficult to practice self-compassion. I actually did some cross-cultural research in the UK. I know not all people on this call are from the UK, but it came slightly near the bottom. So just the feeling of, you can start with some of the, that's kind of, that's a little bit painful. If you feel like you can't practice self-care, our conditioning is so strong toward neglecting ourselves. It's just that moment of letting your heart be moved a little bit by the fact that, I can't even practice self-care. And then that kind of plants the seed, you know, you can be kind to yourself. Because of that, you can kind of be mindful. You can understand that you aren't alone. And then that starts to build. It's like we have a saying in the compassion world, walk slowly, go farther. So you can even just start by practicing compassion for the fact that you find it hard to practice compassion. And then slowly it starts to loosen up. You know, and you also maybe want to try practicing compassion in some ways that feel more comfortable. Maybe putting on some music, something that's easy, or something you already enjoy, like spending time in nature. Or you can experiment with the types of touch. The nice thing about the touch is it doesn't involve the brain. It short circuits the brain. But there is a way, and you might say the train, the locomotive of the train is intention. So if you just set your intention and keep on, you know, trying to relate to whatever's arising with compassion, eventually it will start to arise.
There's lots of great questions coming up here. What's the next one on the list? So it keeps jumping around. Back to this point that about sort of togetherness, but almost the opposite of it. Chris has said, what tips do you have for self-compassion when you're feeling lonely?
It's actually a lot of research showing that self-compassion helps with loneliness. So part of loneliness is just social isolation. And we all felt that during the pandemic. But part of it is also kind of mental isolation. And actually one study showed that people who are more self-compassionate felt less lonely during the pandemic, even though they were socially isolated as everyone else. So, first of all, the loneliness, when you remember that you aren't alone and feeling alone, I mean, it sounds like a paradox, but it's true, right? When you remember that, yeah, everyone needs other people. This is part of being a human being. It hurts when we don't feel connected to others and you aren't alone in feeling that connection, then already you feel more connected than you did, you know, a moment before when you're thinking there's something wrong with me because I feel connected or I feel so alone. And then out of that, so again, that's kind of the tender self-compassion, the fact that just because you feel lonely and isolated doesn't mean there's anything wrong with you. You're unconditionally worthy as a human being. A lot of people feel this. But then this is where some of the action-oriented compassion may come in. You know, are there some things that you can do to help you feel more connected to actual people, which is also important, of course. And then that might provide the fierce self-compassion, might provide the motivation to say, oh, can I join a social club or whatever avenues might be available to you.
Building on this idea of when to nurture ourselves and when to sort of push ourselves in a way. So Avery has asked, how do you balance self-compassion and self-accountability? And I quite like how that's been pushed. So when is the right time? What's the right balance between it's okay, you're okay as you are, versus you can do this, come on, let's make this happen? You know, they both can be self-compassionate to some extent, can't they?
Yeah, well, actually, they work in concert. They aren't opposite. So there's research that shows when you help people be self-compassionate about a mistake they've made or they've hurt someone or, you know, done something they regret, it actually encourages them to take accountability, to apologize or try to repair the situation. So remember that it's not saying that it's okay. It's saying I'm okay. Maybe what I did is not okay, but I'm okay. So even though what I did is not okay, I am still okay. And when we know that we are still okay, that we're still human beings worthy of care and respect and kindness, then that actually gives us the safety to recognize that what I did wasn't okay. If it's not safe, I'm going to blame you, Mark, or someone else. You know what I mean? So we need to feel that bottom line of we are okay, whether or not we make mistakes or do things we deeply regret. And out of that sense of that foundation of acceptance comes the desire to change our behaviors and our actions and kind of the external world in a way that aligns with this sense of care. So they actually don't work against each other. There's a lot of research that shows they work in concert. You do have to be a little careful, though, because the brain is tricky, you know, tricky brain. It always is trying to kind of, you know, fool us. We might think we're being self-compassionate, when in fact, we're really making excuses for ourselves. That's not compassionate. That's actually causing suffering in the long run. It's actually not helping you in the long run. Yeah, sometimes you have to be willing to ask, am I really, is this really helping me? And if not, then maybe I need to do something different to be self-compassionate.
Yeah, it's a bit like back to that parenting analogy. When my
Yes.
daughter says, oh, I don't really want to go to school today. I don't want to have to do my homework. It
Yes.
feels kind to say, don't worry, darling, you don't have to. But actually, in the long run, that isn't the kind thing to do for her.
That's right. Yeah. And so you're being more helpful if you say, no, you need to go to school, but I love you. You know, but when your child knows your love is unconditional, that gives them the sense of safety to be able for you to maybe say, but you know what you're doing, that's not okay. Or maybe even have some consequences, right? But they don't take it personally. And so with ourselves, we don't have to take our mistakes. It's kind of funny, taking responsibility. We can take responsibility without like shaming ourselves in the process, because that actually then makes it harder to take responsibility, not easier.
Yeah. Now, building on this parenting theme, though, a username Little Miss has made a really important point, which is not all of us are lucky enough to have grown up in loving, nurturing parenting environments. How do you learn to be self-compassionate when you don't feel deserving because your parents didn't have compassion for you?
Yeah, no, absolutely. So some people, it comes a little more easily if it was modeled. It can be more challenging. Paul Gilbert in the UK has been absolutely brilliant on this. He's developed something called compassion-focused therapy that is specifically aimed at people who might even be frightened of giving themselves compassion because they feel they don't deserve it, or it may even trigger, you know, trauma memories. We give ourselves unconditional love and we immediately remember all the conditions under which we weren't loved. It's very natural. So again, the way to deal with that, first of all, is just to know that it is hard. It's natural that it's going to be challenging for you. There's nothing wrong with you because of that. And when you feel the pain of not being given compassion, it's actually a good sign because it means the pain is starting to be released, which can be healed. And you can actually learn to give yourself the type of unconditionally supportive parenting that maybe you didn't receive as a child. Right? But it does, especially if your childhood was traumatic, it can really help to work with this with a therapist, to have someone objective to talk through things with you. But really starting with just the pain of that, the moment you, instead of saying, that's right, I am unworthy, when you start to realize, oh, I was told that, I was treated this way, it's not me, it's just a belief system I had. And can I have compassion for the pain of the fact that I was raised with that belief system? Then you're back in the game, and then you can start giving yourself what you really need, which is that unconditional support.
I found that really encouraging and really inspiring. It's not necessarily easy work, but this is the deep work of finding ourselves and actually really making the most of any situation. And linking to this point about how we relate to others, Chantal's asked a fantastic question. How can we compassionately communicate our needs to, for example, take time for self-compassion and emotionally and so on to those around us who maybe don't understand this need? And then that then might then feed more negative self-talk and shame, things like should and can't and must. So how do we let others know, if you like?
Yeah, and so this kind of comes around drawing boundaries, and it is a tricky subject because I would love to be able to say that, yeah, you can draw boundaries and say no, and people don't mind, they'll support you. Actually, there's a reason, just to look at gender role socialization, for instance, there is a reason women were valued for giving themselves away and focusing only on others, because that was really convenient for other people getting their needs met. You know, so people like it when we do it, what they want us to do. And they may give us a little, you know, blowback when we say no. So, you know, you have to be wise, like what's worth it. It may not be worth it to say no in this particular situation. Maybe you'll get fired. That's probably not worth it. But what's really important is that you know that you're worthy of getting your needs met, that you don't buy into the story that your value only comes from doing what other people want. You actually, one of the gifts of self-compassion is authenticity, which means more important than you liking me at some point is me saying my truth. And some people may like you a little bit less. Hopefully they'll also learn to like your authenticity and it won't be a problem. But you know, when you draw a boundary, other people may not like it, but you'll like yourself. You know, having said that, we do want to have balance, and it's not like we don't think of other people's needs. So this is where wisdom comes into play about deciding what's the right thing to do in a particular situation. It's very complicated. But what's
Yeah,
not
but you
complicated is knowing that you have the right to say no, and you have the right to meet your own needs, and you are worthy just like everyone else. That's the uncomplicated bit of this.
Beautifully put. And with Action for Happiness, we have a phrase that sort of unites everything we do: happier, kinder, together. So it's about looking after ourselves, looking after each other, and doing both of those things in harmony with others. And we're out of time, Kristin, and I want to hand back to you for a kind of final thought to wrap this all up. But before we do that, just very briefly, we have a practice that we do at the end of these gatherings as a community. So wherever you are around the world right now, please join me just for a moment to do three things. First of all, let's pause and take a breath and just reconnect with how we're feeling right now in this moment, having spent this time together, and especially with Kristin. And try and bring to mind not only how you're feeling, but maybe something you really appreciate about this time as a community to learn together, to experience for ourselves and with each other, this real insight into how to be more self-compassionate and how to show up in the way that we want to in the world. And then the final third step is just to hold those feelings of appreciation and togetherness and actually send that out into the world. We're so lucky to be here, to have Kristin's time and wisdom, to have each other. And there are many others around the world who haven't yet discovered this wisdom. And we just want to send out some well-wishing, some compassion to other parts of the world, particularly to loved ones you might know, or to causes or areas that could do with more compassion in their lives right now. Thank you all for joining me in that little moment of reflection. Kristin, it's been wonderful to reconnect with you. I think your work is so profound, and we will send, as I said, tomorrow links to your website, your self-compassion community, that wonderful test people can do to find out about their self-compassion, and also the new book. But most importantly, would you like to leave us with a final thought around what we've talked about here today, just to wrap it all up?
Yeah, I mean, so the reason I get so excited about self-compassion is like we all have this superpower. We can change no matter how hard the moment is. If we draw on our ability to feel compassion and kindness and warmth toward ourselves in that moment, it changes everything. And it's free, and it's as close as your eyelash to your face. It's just a simple mindset shift. And if we can remember to do it, then it's an incredible source of strength and coping. Easier than you think, and instantaneously powerful.
That's wonderful. Thank you, everyone, for being here for our 100th live event. Kristin, thank you so much for your time. Keep up the amazing work, and look forward to doing this again soon. Thanks.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks for all you do.